Oh, you who believe, give charity for the pleasure of Allah, the pleasure of Allah. Oh, you who believe, read the Quran every night of Ramadan, night of Ramadan. Welcome, O Ramadan. Ramadan, it is Ramadan.
Dear brothers and sisters in Islam and humanity, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. Welcome to the show, Ramadan, A Date with Dr. Zakia. I'm your host, Yusuf Chambers, and today we will be discussing the topic, Qiyam al-Layl, the night prayer. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
A very interesting topic once again, and the first question I have for you is, as we've often been doing, first question, what is the meaning of the term Qiyam al-Layl? And can you give us the differentiation between that term and Taraweeh, which is often misconstrued?
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam, ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain, amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Rabbi shahli sadri, as far as the word Qiyam al-Layl is concerned, it is broken up into two words, Qiyam. Qiyam means to stand, and al-Layl means the night. So literally it means standing in the night. But in the Sharia, in the Islamic context, it means it is a voluntary prayer which is prayed after Isha and before the break of dawn. And as we are aware that Isha starts after the redness of the sky disappears after sunset, and you can pray this Qiyam al-Layl just before the break of dawn, before the time of Fajr. So Qiyam, the word Qiyam al-Layl was given because a person in this voluntary prayer, he recites long verses of the Quran. So the standing is long. Therefore, it is called as standing in the night, the prayer where you have to stand for a long time. And there are various different words which are used for the same Qiyam al-Layl. For example, it's also called as Salatul Layl, meaning the prayer at night. It's also called as Tahajjud. It's also called as Witr, also as Taraweeh. Salatul Layl, as I mentioned, means prayer at night, similar to standing in the night, but natural for praying. The other word used is tahajjud, coming from the word hajada, which means to wake up. So when a person sleeps and he wakes up to pray, it's called as tahajjud also. The other word used is witr, witr meaning odd. And the Prophet always say that we have to, after Isha Salah, we should offer witr in odd rakats. And the other name used is Taraweeh. Taraweeh comes from the Arabic word raha, which means to rest, which means to relax. Because after a few generations after the Prophet, people, when they used to read the Qiyam al-Layl in Ramadan especially, this word Taraweeh is mainly used for Qiyam al-Layl in Ramadan. So when they used to pray the Qiyam al-Layl in Ramadan, after 4 rakat they used to rest. So this word Taraweeh, from that time onwards, it got stuck to this Qiyam al-Layl in Ramadan, it's called as Taraweeh. Normally after 4 rakat they used to rest. And this has continued because they used to pray for long hours. And even now, though they pray for a short time, a few verses, yet in the Qiyam al-Layl during Ramadan, they stop. So the word is yet used as Taraweeh. But at the time of the Prophet, this word Taraweeh was never used. Even while praying during Ramadan, this word was never used. Even the Sahaba never used this word. It came down later on. So the more appropriate word is Qiyamul Layl. Taraweeh is not the right appropriate word, but it came later on. But if a person, when he reads for a long time, Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan, if he wants to rest, he can rest. But it's not forbidden to rest. The person is tired and he wants to rest, he can rest, but it's not compulsory he has to rest. So the more appropriate word is Qiyamul Layl, and it's not Taraweeh.
Dr. Zakia, next question is, could you tell us something of the excellence of the night prayer, Qiyamul Layl, in Islam?
As far as the excellence of Qiyamul Layl, the night prayer, is concerned, there are several verses in the Quran, there are several hadith talking about it. I'll just mention a few of them. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Sajdah, chapter number 32, verse number 16, talking about those people who are people of paradise, those who go to Jannah, and he describes these people that their limbs do forsake the bed of sleep, and they call to their Lord in fear and hope. That means they leave aside their sleep and they pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in hope and in fear, in taqwa. And it continues, and they give in charity from the sustenance they have given, talking about the people of Jannah. Further, if you read in the Quran, it's mentioned in Surah Dhariyat, chapter number 51, verse number 17 and 18, that these people, talking about the people of Jannah and the righteous people, they sleep very little in night. And during the early hours of dawn, these people, they pray for forgiveness. Allah further says in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 64, that these are the people who spend their night in adoration of their Lord, standing and in prostration, in qiyam and in sujood. There are various verses in the Quran. There are various hadith talking about the excellence of this night prayer. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 1, in the Book of Fasting, hadith number 2612. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said that the best prayer after the prescribed prayers, after the prayers which are obligatory, which are fard, it is the night prayer. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the Book of Tahajjud, hadith number 1131. The beloved Prophet said, the best prayer is the prayer of Dawud alayhi salam. And the best fasting is the fasting of Dawud alayhi salam. And Dawud alayhi salam, he is to sleep the first half of the night. Then he is to spend the next one third of the night in praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the rest of it, the one sixth of night, he is to again sleep. Here again talking about the excellence of the night prayer. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the Book of Tahajjud, hadith number 1142, our beloved Prophet said that when a person sleeps, the satan, he ties 3 knots at the back of his head. And after tying each knot, he whispers and he blows and says, the night is long, so keep on sleeping. And when a person gets up and remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first knot is undone. When he does the wudu, the second knot is undone. And when he prays, the third knot is undone. And the person is energetic. And inshallah, he'll be on the straight path for the full day. On the other hand, if he gets up without taking the name of Allah, without doing wudu, without offering salah, then he's lazy and his heart is mischievous. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad further said, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 1, in the Book of Salah, hadith number 1656. Our beloved Prophet said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he descends to the lowest part of the heaven in the last one third of the night. And he says that, is there anyone who wants to supplicate to me and I will answer him? Is there anyone who wants to ask from me and I will give it to him? Is there anyone who wants to seek forgiveness and I will forgive him? Is there anyone who wants to invest a good deed with me? For I am not unjust and not wasteful. And he continues this till the break of dawn. And there are various excellence spoken about the night prayer. For example, in a Sahih Hadith of Tirmidhi, Book of Supplications, Hadith number 3579, our beloved Prophet Muhammad said that the servant is the closest to his Lord in the last one third of the night. And if he asks him, and if he prays to him during this time, it is the best time that he can pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's mentioned in a Sahih Hadith of Tirmidhi in the Book of Supplications, Hadith number 3499, that when a person asked that which is the best time to pray, the beloved Prophet ﷺ said that the best time that a prayer will be answered is during the last one third of the night and after the prescribed prayers, after the five obligatory prayers. If you supplicate, then inshallah that's the best time to ask for supplication and the last one third of the night. It's mentioned in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the Book of Salah, Hadith number 1417, the beloved Prophet Muhammad said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has added one more prayer for you, that is the witr. And if anyone wants to pray 5 rakat in witr, he may do so. If anyone wants to pray 3 rakat for witr, he may do so. If anyone wants to pray 1 rakat for witr, he may do so. It's further mentioned Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the Book of Salat, Hadith number 1303. The beloved Prophet Muhammad said that a person who gets up in the middle of the night and prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and wakes up his wife, and if she doesn't wake up, then sprinkle some water on her. Allah's mercy and blessing is on such people. And the hadith further continues that Allah's mercy and blessing are on those women who wake up in the middle of the night and they pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they wake up their husbands. And if the husbands don't wake up, they sprinkle water on them. So again, it is one of the best prayers after the obligatory prayers. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad further said, it's mentioned in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the Book of Salah, Hadith number 1302. The Prophet's wife, Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she said that the Prophet used to always pray the Qiyamul Layl and he never missed it. Even when he was sick and ill or lethargic, he used to pray, even though he used to pray while sitting. He never missed it. So this was a few of the hadith and few Quranic verses which speak about the excellence of the night prayer.
Wow. Thank you very much for the answer, Dr. Zakir, and I'm sure that that's very useful and informative for our viewers to know all about the excellence of the night prayer. In Islam generally, of course. Now I want to move on to discussing Qiyam al-Layl in terms of Ramadan. Could you give us some information about Qiyam al-Layl in the month of Ramadan?
All the advantages, all the blessings, all the excellence which are there, which I spoke in the earlier answer for Qiyam al-Layl generally, is multiplied in the time of Ramadan. Ramadan is the month of mercy, as we discussed earlier, and you get more sawab, you get multiple times, more sawab 10 times to 700 times. So all the excellence discussed in the normal time, in the month of Ramadan, it is multiplied. And the beloved Prophet ﷺ said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, in the Book of Fasting, Hadith number 2009, that anyone who offers the night prayer in the month of Ramadan with the belief and with seeking Allah's reward, all his past sins will be forgiven. And it's mentioned in the Sahih Hadith of Sahih Ibn Hibban, Hadith number 3438, that the person who comes to Muhammad and asks him that what if I say there is no God worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has got no partners, and Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if I offer 5 times obligatory salah prayers, and if I fast in the month of Ramadan, and if I pray in the night during Ramadan, if I offer the night prayer in Ramadan, Qiyamul Layl, and if I give zakat, then what is my position? So the beloved Prophet said that anyone who does all these things, he will be amongst the Siddiqeen, the righteous people, and among the Shuhada, amongst the martyrs. So this is the importance. Everything is the same, but it's multiplied will be called amongst the righteous people and amongst those who are martyrs. And therefore, a person should see to it that he should offer the Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan. It's very important. He should not miss it. And furthermore, besides the spiritual benefits that all that I discussed in the previous answer, there are even physical benefits. When a person fasts for the full day, then during iftar he eats, and then if he offers Qiyamul Layl, it is good for the body. The body is fasting, then he stands, he in the posture of bowing, then the sujood. It's a good exercise. And besides getting spiritual benefits, it even gets physical benefits. So as far as possible, a person should see to it that he should not miss the Qiyamul Layl.
Excellent. I'm sure that a lot of people are going to be praying the night prayer now after you've given that good advice. The next question is relating to the time that Qiyamul Layl should be practiced during the night. What's the best time during the night?
Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Hadith of Musnad Ahmad, volume number 6, page number 7. The beloved Prophet Muhammad said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has added one more prayer, that is the witr. So pray witr between Isha and Fajr. That means the time of Isha is after sunset when the redness in the sky disappears. That is the time of Isha. So after you offer Isha, you can pray any time before the break of dawn, before the time of Fajr starts. This is the earliest and the latest where you can pray the Qiyamul Layl. And as I mentioned earlier, witr is another name for Qiyamul Layl. And our beloved Prophet said, it's mentioned in Musannaf Abdul Razzaq, Hadith number 4623, that our beloved Prophet said that if someone fears that he will not wake up in the night, then he can offer the witr or the Qiyamul Layl in the early part of the night. But if a person knows that he's going to get up at night, he should pray at night after he gets up from sleep. Because praying in the later part of the night is much better, where angels witness for the person. And as I mentioned earlier, the hadith I mentioned earlier of Sahih Muslim, volume number 1, hadith number 1656. It's a hadith which is also there in Sahih Bukhari with a different wording. It is muttafiq alayk. It also occurs in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2. In the book of Tahajjud, hadith number 1145, our beloved Prophet said that Allah the Supreme, the Glorious, He descends to the lowest part of the heaven during the last one-third of the night. And then He asks, is there anyone who is supplicating to me so that I can answer his supplication? Is there anyone who is begging to me so that I can give him? Is there anyone who's asking forgiveness so that I can forgive him? It's the muttafiq alayk hadith, occurs in Sahih Muslim, also in Sahih Bukhari. It further mentioned in the hadith of Tirmidhi, in the book of supplications, hadith number 3579, that the closest a servant is to his creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is during the last one-third of the night. And if he prays to him during that time, it's the best. So the Qiyamul Layl, the witr, it's immediately after Isha is the earliest you can pray, up to the break of dawn. But the best time is the last one-third of the night. And that's what is further mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, hadith number 2010, where Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he said when people were offering the Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan immediately after Isha, that it's good, but it would have been better if they offered the last one-third of the night. So praying in the last one-third is the best. But you can start immediately after Isha and pray just before the break of dawn, before the Fajr time. But in the mosque generally, majority of the mosques, they have immediately after Isha, that is approximately 2 hours after the break of fast, after sunset, plus minus half an hour, most of the mosques, because it's convenient. Because there are people who are young in the congregation, there are people who are elderly people, there are women. So to make it easier and not to make life difficult for them, because most of them is difficult for them to get up in the middle of the night. So in majority of the mosques, they have it immediately after Isha, about maybe 2 hours or 2.5 hours after the break of fast, which is no problem at all. It's better to pray than not to pray. Better to pray early than not to pray. But the best time is the last one third of the night. So if some of the mosques have during the last one third of the night, no Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan, that's the best. But the majority of the mosques have it earlier, which there's no problem at all.
Okay, good. I think you can do both, of course. Alhamdulillah.
Allah has made life easy for us.
May Allah allow us to do it the whole month, inshallah, and take all the benefits that you've mentioned and will continue to mention during this interview and the question and answer sessions to come up, inshallah. Dr. Zakir, the next question is relating to the etiquettes of the night prayer. Could you explain some of the most essential etiquettes of the night prayer?
There are some hadiths which give us some guidance. There's a hadith which is a Sahih hadith according to Sheikh Albani. It's a hadith of Bayhaqi, where it says that our beloved Prophet ﷺ said that when you get up in the middle of the night, then you use the siwak, and then you do wudu and then offer salah. So using the siwak is a sunnah. Further, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the book of Tahajjud, hadith number 1154, where the beloved Prophet Muhammad said, and he gave certain things that when a person gets up in the middle of the night, he can recite, La ilaha illallahu, wadahu la sharika lahu, lahul mulku lahul hamdu, wa ala kulli shayin qadir, walhamdulillahi, subhanallahi, wa la ilaha illallah wallahu akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And then you can recite, Allahumma aghfirli, Allah forgive me, Allah forgive me. So these are recitations that you can do when you get up. Our beloved Prophet ﷺ said, the Sahih hadith of Sunan Nisa'i, hadith number 1621, where the beloved Prophet said that when he used to get up in the middle of the salah, Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she said that whenever the Prophet used to get up in the middle of the night, he used to recite, Subhan Rabbil Alameen, means glory be to Allah, the Lord of the worlds. He used to recite several times. He used to even recite, Subhanallah wa bihamdi, glory be to Allah and praise be to Him, several times. So these are a few of the etiquettes for a person when he gets up in the middle of the night to offer the salah. And there's also hadith of Sunan Abu Dawud. It's a Sahih hadith, volume number 1 in the book of Salah, hadith number 1324. Once when Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the night when he was passing by, he heard Hazrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, reciting the Qiyamul Layl. And you could hear his voice. And later on, he hears the voice of Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him. When both of them come to him the next day, he says to Hazrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, that I could hear your voice. It was soft. It was low. Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, he replies, that the person who I was praying to, he could hear it. Therefore, I was praying softly. Then he says to Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, that your voice was loud. So he said that I was trying to wake up those people who were sleeping, and I was trying to shoo away the devil, the shayateen. I was trying to drive them off. So then the Prophet says to Hazrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, that you should increase your voice while offering the Qiyamul Layl. And he told to Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, that you should lower your voice while offering Qiyamul Layl. That means your voice should be moderate, neither too loud, neither too soft, while offering the Qiyamul Layl. And there's another hadith, which is a Sahih hadith, mentioned in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 1322, that Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that whenever the Prophet offered the Qiyamul Layl, you could hear his voice in the inner room when he was reciting in the house. That means the voice was moderate, neither too loud, neither too soft. So these are a few of the etiquettes of Qiyamul Layl.
Okay, thank you very much, Doctor. The next question relates really to the length of time, the length that one should make the night prayer. Is there any indications from Quran Sunnah relating to the length?
There are various hadith talking about it, and the length can vary, but the Sunnah of the Prophet was that he used to pray usually for long hours. And the hadith in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the book of Tahajjud, hadith number 1135, that Asaba says that I joined the Prophet one night while he was offering the Qiyamul Layl. And it was so long that the evil thought came to me. So when he was asked, what was the evil thought? He felt like sitting down and keeping the Prophet standing. That means it was so long. There's another hadith in Sahih Muslim, volume number 1, in the Book of Salah, hadith number 1697, where it says that once a Sahaba, he prays the Qiyamul Layl along with Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and the Prophet started reciting Surah Baqarah. And the Sahaba says that when we finished about 100 verses, he thought the Prophet would bow down, but the Prophet continued. Then later on, he thought that another after some verses, he would bow down, but he continued. Then he thought that, okay, maybe after Surah Baqarah ends, the Prophet would bow down. But after Surah Baqarah ends, he continues reciting. He recites Surah Nisa. And that again is 176 verses. And after that ends, he recites Surah Al-Imran. And he continues leisurely. That means Prophet used to pray for hours. Imagine, Surah Baqarah, Surah Nisa, Surah Al-Imran. It is about, all put together, at least 5 juz. Imagine, only in that one rakah. So this was the length at minion time. But there's no fixed length. A person can vary as much as. Well, the Prophet always preferred praying longer. Further, it's mentioned in a Sahih hadith of Sunnah Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the Book of Salah, hadith number 873. The beloved Prophet, one of the Sahaba, says that when he used to pray, he started the Qiyamul Layl, and he, after Surah Fatiha, he read Surah Baqarah. Then he went in the ruku, in the bowing position. And when he was in the bowing position, he stayed there as long as he was standing before. Then he got up, he put his head straight, and he was in the standing position till as much time as he was in the bowing position. Then he goes in the sujood. And the Prophet was, but naturally he says that he said, Sumara bin Nazim in the ruku, glory be to Allah. And then in the sujood he says, Sumara bin Allah, glory be to Allah, who is the highest. And he was in the sujood position as long as he was in the standing position. And in between the two sujood also, he was as long as he was in the sujood position, saying that all these positions, qiyam, the ruku, the standing after ruku, the sujood, and the sitting between the two sujood, he used to take his own time and it used to be long. That means the qiyam layl was very long. There's another hadith in Sahih Muslim, volume number 4, hadith number 6774, Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she says that the Prophet, while offering Qiyamul Layl, the night prayer, he used to stand for such long hours that his feet used to swell. So his wife, Hazrat Aisha, anha, may Allah be pleased with her, she says that all your past and the future sins have been forgiven. So why do you ask for forgiveness so much? Why do you pray for so long? So he said, shouldn't I be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So all the more reason he says you should be thankful. So the Prophet normally used to pray for long hours. So the longer you offer the Qiyamul Layl, the better it is.
Well, may Allah give the strength to utilize the night prayer with length, like you've described the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to have done. Alhamdulillah. Dr. Zakir, is it better, according to Quran and Sunnah, to offer the Qiyamul Layl individually or in congregation?
There are hadith which say that a person can offer Qiyamul Layl individually, also in congregation. Both accepted, and all the references I gave, most of them the Prophet used to offer together. And I gave some references when the Sahaba used to join the Prophet, so both are there. But as far as which is better, but natural, there are various hadith in Sahih Bukhari saying that if you offer in congregation, you get 27 times more sawab. And all the two hadith saying that. And further, as far as the Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan is concerned, there's a hadith in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, in the book of Tarawih, hadith number 2012, where once the Prophet, he goes to the mosque, and there he finds that people are offering in the groups. So he offers Salah, the Qiyamul Layl, at night, and many people joined behind him. Next day, the news spreads. And the next night, the full mosque is filled with people. The third night, again, when the Prophet comes to offer the Qiyamul Layl, the mosque is overflowing with people in the congregation, but naturally. The fourth night, again, it is overfilled. But the Prophet, he knows people are waiting out again to join him for Qiyamul Layl. He does not go out purposely. And during Fajr, after offering the Fajr Salah, after the Salah is over, and he says that not that I was not aware that the people were waiting for me for the Qiyamul Layl, but I did not want to make it compulsory for you. I don't want people to think that it's compulsory to offer Qiyamul Layl, lest it would be difficult for you. So purposely Prophet gave a break to make it known to the people that it's not fard to offer Qiyamul Layl, and he didn't want to make it difficult for the people. But from the hadith you come to know that offering Jama'ah is better. And there's another hadith in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 1370. One is the Prophet was offering Qiyamul Layl, and he finishes, and when he's about to get up, people say that, why don't you pray more? So the Prophet says that anyone who prays till the Imam finishes, if he prays with the Imam till he finishes, it is as though he has prayed for the full night. So from these two hadiths we come to know that offering Qiyamul Layl in congregation is better than offering individually, irrespective whether it's in Ramadan or outside Ramadan.
Okay, thank you, Doctor. And actually there's another issue which has come up in my own research, and it relates to the fact that many people consider it a bid'ah to go into congregation and pray the Qiyamul Layl. And this started in the Khalifa of Umar radiallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with him. Could you comment on this?
People have a misconception that Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he was the one who started this congregation Salah, Qiyamul Layl, during Ramadan. It's a misconception. But in fact, it is he who revived the Sunnah of the Prophet. As I mentioned earlier, in the hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, in the book of Tarawih, hadith number 2012, that the Prophet was the person who offered Qiyamul Layl. People joined him in congregation and he allowed it. Then later on, next night, the whole mosque was filled. And third night, it was overflowing. And fourth night, didn't come out purposely. From this hadith, we come to know that it was the Prophet who started this and Sunnah of the Prophet. But at the time of Hazrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, there were hardly any people who prayed that. Even in the starting of the caliphate of Hazrat Umar, it was the same thing, may Allah be pleased with him. It further mentioned the hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, in the book of Tarawih, hadith number 2010. The Sahaba says that he was walking along with Hazrat Umar, one of the mosque, may Allah be pleased with him, and he finds that people were praying individually, and some people were praying in a small group. So Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he gathered all the people and he said, let's make one Jama'ah. And he appointed Ubay ibn Ka'ib, may Allah be pleased with him, to lead the Salah. And everyone prayed behind him. And later on, when he comes back after a few nights, he finds that people are praying in one congregation. And then he comments, it is preferable to pray when the people are sleeping than what they are praying now. Because, you know, they prayed immediately after Isha Salah, as I mentioned earlier. So praying the Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan, what people call as Tarawih, it's preferable to pray in the last one third of night. But if you pray early also, it's no problem. Now, coming back to the question, when he said that it's an excellent bid'ah, people misunderstand the statement and they say, oh, that means the bid'ah can be good. Bid'ah is normally in the Sharia, means an innovation in the religion. But here, Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he never used it as a bid'ah in the religion. There's nothing like bid'ah which is good. You know, because it's mentioned in the hadith of Sahih Muslim, volume number 1, hadith number 1885, that all innovations in the religion are wrong and they lead to error. And another hadith says that all innovations lead to hellfire. So all innovations are wrong. Now, based on this hadith, when Umar, may Allah please him, said that it's an excellent bid'ah, so people normally say that bid'ah can be good and can be bad, good bid'ah is allowed. So what he really meant here was bid'ah in the linguistic term, not bid'ah in the religion. Because in linguistic term, bid'ah means something which is new. So at that time, people did not pray in one congregation. So he reminded them of the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So it was going back to the sunnah of the Prophet, but for that time it was bid'ah linguistically, it was something new. So it doesn't mean that Hazrat Umar, may Allah pleased with him, he innovated something in the religion. He took the people back to the sunnah of the Prophet. For example, if I go to a city where people are wearing the trousers below the ankle, and if I say that, you know, wearing above the ankle is the sunnah of the Prophet. But it's a bid'ah for that time, because people, it's new for them. They don't know about it. So it's bid'ah for that time, but it's going back to the sunnah of the Prophet, wearing the trousers above the ankle. So people misunderstand the statement of Umar, may Allah pleased with him, talking about new for that time and for that place and for the people. But actually, it's going back to the Prophet. So it is not what Hazrat Umar, may Allah pleased with him, he innovated it. He told the people that this is what the Prophet did. And there are several such examples. Many Muslims, you know, temporary marriage done by some groups of Muslims, the Prophet had prohibited that. Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he knew about it. So during the 7th Hijri of Tabuk, he said it is wrong. So people think he imposed it. But he knew the Prophet said it was haram, the temporary marriage. You know, it's called as muta. So just because he implemented the sunnah, which very few people knew at that time, and he was there when the Prophet said that muta, temporary marriage, is haram, people think that he brought it into the deen. It's going back the sunnah of the Prophet. Hope that clarifies.
Well, jazakallah khair, Dr. Zakir. Dr. Zakir, I would call upon you to resolve one of the most common disputes in the Muslim Ummah during the month of Ramadan regarding the number of rakat that are prayed in the Taraweeh, or the Qiyam al-Layl, or the night prayer. Is it 8, or should it be 20?
Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the Book of Salah, hadith number 472, he said that when a person asks that how should you offer the Qiyam al-Layl, the Prophet said that he should offer Qiyam al-Layl in 2 rakat, followed by 2 rakat, followed by 2 rakat, followed by 2 rakat, and so on. And when he fears that dawn is approaching, he should offer 1 rakat. So all the rakat become witr, become odd. That means you can pray as many as you wish. Later on, have one number, an odd number, so that everything becomes odd. So as far as the number of rakats are concerned, you can pray as many as you wish. But as far as the practice of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is concerned, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the Book of Tahajjud, hadith number 1147, that Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she says that the Prophet, while offering Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan, used to always offer 11 rakat, not more than 11 rakat. And this he used to do even in other months. That means 8 rakat of Qiyamul Layl and 3 rakat of Witr. So it becomes 8 plus 3, 11 rakat. And there are various other hadith which always say that all the hadith that we find of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, whether it be in Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, all of them said that he prayed 8 rakat or this 11 rakat. 11 includes 8 plus 3. And further, the same hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the Book of Tahajjud, hadith number 1147, Hazrat Aisha, may Allah pleased with her, when she says that the Prophet always offered 11 rakat in Ramadan and even other times. And she said that he used to offer 4 rakat. And I cannot narrate to you the time, the beauty, and the length of this rakat. And it's to again offer 4 rakat. And I cannot narrate to you the beauty and the length of this 4 rakat. And then it's to offer 3 rakat, indicating 8 plus 3. But if you read the practice of the Salaf al-Salihin, of our predecessors, of the Sahabas, the Tabain, Tabi Tabain, We find from records that they prayed 11 rakat, some prayed 13, some prayed 19, some prayed 23, some prayed 36, some prayed 39 rakats also. And if you read the Musannaf Ibn Abi Shayba, volume number 2, page number 165, 166, it says that the Tabaeen, when they offered the Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan, which is known as Taraweeh, they offered 20 rakat. Some place it says that they offered 36 rakat. So as far as the rakats are concerned, as the Prophet, the call, the commander of the Prophet was that read two rakat, as much as you wish, then one. And as I mentioned earlier in Sahih Bukhari, hadith number 472, volume number 1, you can read as many rakats as you want, in two, and then one. But if you want to follow the sunnah of the Prophet always offered 8 rakat plus 3. So what is permissible? As many as you wish. 8, 10, 20, 36, no problem. And then followed by 3 witr. But the Prophet offered 8 plus 3, 11. But you can offer as many as you wish.
Well, of course, you've mentioned that one could pray as much as you like in terms of the number of rakah. But the sunnah is 8. This is what you've said.
That's it. Prophet offered 8.
Alhamdulillah.
But he permitted you can offer as many as you wish.
Right, right. So as many as you like, but the sunnah is 8. However, if a person or a group of people pray 8 in 1 hour and another group of people pray 20 in 1.5 hours, which would you say is the best?
So your question has got two portions. One is the number of rakat, other is the length. As I mentioned in the earlier answer, that the longer it is, the better it is. The Prophet said that. And the other is that any rakat is fine, Prophet offered 8. Now, you know, 8 and 1 hour is better, or 20 and 1.5 hour is better? Before I answer this question, I'll tell you that if a person is offering his salah in a mosque which is praying in congregation 8 rakat, he should not get up and pray additional 12 and make it 20, because he feels 20 is better. Neither should a person who's offering Taraweeh or the Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan offers his Qiyamul Layl in a mosque which is offering 20 rakat in Jama. He should not offer 8 rakat and walk out, because the Prophet said that a person who prays along with the Imam and ends with the Imam, it is as though he has offered the Salah for the whole night. So we should be more tolerant and agree that the Prophet allowed all types. If a person wants to offer 20, if he's offering in a mosque of 8 rakat in Jama'at, offer 8 rakat in Jama'at, he can go home and offer the remaining balance of the 20, that's 12 rakat. As far as the question is concerned, which is better, 8 rakat and 1 hour, or 20 rakat and 1.5 hour? Here again, as I said, that the call, the commandment of the Prophet is that you can offer as many as you wish, and the longer it is, the longer it is better. But the Prophet offered long and 8 rakat. So if you ask me which is better, both acceptable, but the better would be that if he offers the same length, but with 8 rakat. Same length, 8 rakat, whether it be 1 hour, 2 hour, or 3 hours. So if you ask me 1 hour with 8 rakat is better, or 1 hour with 20 rakat is better, I would prefer 1 hour with 8 rakat. But as your question is, if it's 1 hour with 8 rakat and 1.5 hour with 20 rakat, I would prefer 20 rakat, 1.5 hour. Because the call of the Prophet is longer the better, which you're doing. And again, the call is you can offer as many as you wish. So I would prefer 20 rakat and 1.5 hour rather than 8 rakat and 1 hour. And that's what we see in the Harmain. They're 20 rakat, but they're long for approximately 2 hours there. And in the other mosque, they have 8 rakat and shorter duration. But in both the Harmain, Masjid Haram in Makkah and Medina, mashallah, they are for long hours. As it is, the Harmain, you get multiple rewards. You get 1,000 times in the Masjid Nabawi and 100,000 in Masjid Haram, Makkah.
Yes, absolutely. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Zakir, regarding that superb answer. Last question in the interview phase. Dr. Zakir, relating to women now, are women allowed to pray the Taraweeh in congregation in the masjid?
As far as women being allowed to pray in the masjid, our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 834, the Prophet said, that do not prevent the female servants of Allah from going to the mosque. The Prophet said in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 865, that if the woman asks you permission to go to the mosque, even at night, you give it to them. That means even going at night, but natural for Qiyamul Layl or for Isha Salah, you give it to them. Talking about Tarawih, they give it to them. And further, it's mentioned in the hadith of Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, book of Salah, hadith number 1370. It narrates about Muhammad had iftar along with the family and the women and all of them. And then they prayed at night, the Qiyamul Layl. And they nearly missed their falah. Falah is success. Talking about the pre-dawn meal, talking about suhoor, which we discussed earlier. They nearly missed their suhoor, indicating that the full family along with the women, the family, they prayed together with Muhammad, saying it's allowed. Further, it's mentioned in the hadith of Sahih Muslim, point number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 881. The beloved Prophet, he said that the best row for the men in Salah are the first rows, and the worst is the last row. The best row for the women are the last rows, and the worst rows are the front rows. That means the women can go in the mosque to offer Salah, even Qiyamul Layl. But there are some etiquettes. The men should be in the first row, and the women should be in the last rows. And they should be careful. They should not create a fitna. That's important. Not have, you know, where sometimes ladies come with all glamorous dresses and they wear adornments and ornaments, etc. As the Quran says in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 31, say to the believing woman that she should lower her gaze and guard her modesty and display not her beauty except what appears ordinarily of, and draw her veil over the bosom. That means in unnecessary, too much of glamour, ornaments, etc. And Quran says in Surah Ahzab, chapter 33, verse 59, that, O Prophet, tell your wives, your daughters, and the believing women, when they go abroad, when they go out, they should put on the jilbab, the cloak. So they should be careful that they should wear the jilbab when they go for Salah, for the Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan or to the mosque, and should not make a fitna. As long as they don't make a fitna and they don't unnecessarily put perfume and attraction, they can go, alhamdulillah. It is fine, it is good. And it's further mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 849, that the Prophet, after when he led the congregation, he turned to the people and he waited. And the women immediately got up and they left. And the narrator says that, you know, maybe the Prophet did that purpose so that he didn't want the men and women to meet. You know, so you should be careful, you should not create a fitna. So women can go to the mosque and they can offer the Tarawih. It's perfectly fine. It was a practice at the time of the Prophet.
Thank you very much for that final answer. I think we've, once again, we've learned an awful lot about this particular aspect, the night prayer, Qiyam al-Layl, during the month of Ramadan, alhamdulillah, and hopefully we will all take as much benefit as possible and implement it during this Ramadan and the coming Ramadans, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. So we've made this special show, and I'd like to answer as many questions as possible on the topic from our viewers. Hundreds and hundreds of emails, as usual, and, you know, it never changes, does it? Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah.
The first couple of questions from our viewers, again. Question number 1. Is the Tarawih prayer a sunnah or is it a fard? Can a person miss it?
As far as the question is concerned, that is Tarawih or is Qiyamul Layl during Ramadan, is it fard or is it a sunnah? As we discussed earlier, our beloved Prophet ﷺ said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, in the book of Tarawih, hadith number 2012, and it gives how Muhammad ﷺ offered in the mosque Qiyamul Layl during Ramadan, and people joined him. The next day the news spread, and when he came the next day, the full mosque was filled. The third day it was overflowing, and fourth day, purposely, though the mosque was overflowing, he did not come out for Qiyamul Layl, for the Tarawih, which people call. And when he came for the Fajr Salah, he said, not that he did not know that people were waiting for me, but I purposely didn't come because I didn't want offering the Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan is a fard. So from this hadith, we come to know that it is not a fard. But the other hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, Book of Tarawih, hadith number 2009, the beloved Prophet said that anyone who offers the night prayer in Ramadan with the belief and seeking Allah's reward, all his past sins will be forgiven. So based on this, you come to know, though it's not a fard, it's a very important sunnah. It's sunnah-e-muqaddah. That means a very highly recommended sunnah of the Prophet. Though it's not a fard, it's sunnah-e-muqaddah, very highly recommended sunnah. And no Muslim should miss it unless he really has a valid reason. He should, as far as possible, offer it and seek Allah's reward, so all his sins will be forgiven.
Jazakallah khair.
Next question from our viewer. Many imams recite the Quran in a very fast way during the Taraweeh or Qiyam al-Layl. They also perform ruku and sujood in a fast manner, which makes it difficult for the followers to supplicate properly. Is it allowed to pray in this manner?
It is very common that many of the mosques, because they want to finish the full Quran in the month of Ramadan in Taraweeh, and they want to make it as short as possible so people finish it, they do recite very fast, and very often you see that they go in the ruku and sujood very fast. And many a time, once I was in one of the mosques, and when the imam went in the sujood, I went after him. He got up again, went again. I was yet in my first sujood and he was doing the second sujood. Allahu Akbar. So is it right or is it wrong? It's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the Book of Salah, hadith number 757, that once the Prophet enters the mosque, and there is another man who follows him, he offers the Salah. And after offering Salah, that man, he wishes the Prophet Assalamu Alaikum. The Prophet greets back and says that, go back and pray because you have not prayed. The man goes back and he comes back to the Prophet. The Prophet says, go back and pray, you have not prayed. Again, the person goes for the third time. He prays and he comes back. The Prophet again says, go back and pray, for you have not prayed, for the third time. So the man says, I cannot pray better than this. O Prophet, please teach me how to pray. So then the Prophet says that after seeing the takbir, you recite while standing in the qiyam as much of the Quran that you know by heart, whatever the Quran you know by heart, you recite. Then you bow down, go in your ruku, until you are at ease. And then say, glory be to Allah, Subhanahu bin Nazim. Then stand up straight until you are at ease. Then go in sujood with calmness until you are at ease. And then say, Subhanahu bin Allah, glory be to Allah, who is the Most High, thrice. Then get up again until you are at ease. And then continue your prayer like that. That means all, especially your ruku and your sujood. And when you get up from your ruku, and in between the sujood, you should be at ease. You can't go up and down fast. If you do that, it is as though your prayer has not been accepted, as though you have not prayed. So if you pray in this fast manner, Taraweeh, where ruku, sujood, and fast, it is as though you have not prayed. So it is best that you pray slowly, with calmness. And if you really feel that you can't offer 20, then offer 8 rakah, but with peace, with ease, and with calmness. The best is that with peace, ease, and calmness, and long. Taraweeh should be long. It should not be having competition with the other mosques, you know, which we have many a times. When the many mosques, they compete, who is going to finish the Taraweeh faster?
Yes, that's very unfortunate, but it's true. Well, next question is it compulsory that the imam should recite the complete Quran in the nights of Ramadan in Taraweeh? Is it necessary that the followers should listen to the whole of the Quran in Taraweeh? So two parts of the question.
There is no hadith in which the Prophet has mentioned or in Sahaba that it is compulsory to recite the full Quran. It is preferable. It is mustahab. It's better. Because, you know, if you recite as much as the Quran in the month of Ramadan, it's good for you. So many people may not be reciting at home. So at least during the Qiyam al-Layl in Ramadan, the people at least listen to the Quran. So it's preferable, it's not a fard. But naturally, if it's recited, in the Qiyam al-Layl, it's obligatory for the Muttadi, for the people praying behind to listen. But it's not a fard that you should recite the full Quran. But most of the mosques, majority of the mosques, complete the Quran because it's good, mashallah. There are some mosques which I know that it becomes difficult for people to listen, because you know, if you have to recite the full Quran, the full month of Ramadan, it is about one juz a day, somewhere close to that. And it becomes difficult. So there are some mosques which pray half juz on average. So they finish half the Quran in the full month of Ramadan. Next Ramadan, they finish the next half. All is acceptable, but it's preferable to finish the full Quran. You know, unless you know that there are small children and they cannot offer. So one or two mosques have it, alhamdulillah, no problem. But preferable to finish the full Quran, but it's not compulsory.
Next question. Where should a woman pray Taraweeh? I think we've answered partly onto this question. At home or in the masjid? If she prays at home, can she lead the congregation or a congregation of women?
It's mentioned in Sahih Tarqib, Hadith number 336, where the beloved Prophet said that the best mosque for a woman is her innermost room, her innermost chamber. And the best place for a woman to pray is her inner room. That's the best. And in another hadith of Musnad Ahmad, point number 6, hadith number 27202, which also mentioned in Sahih At-Targhib, hadith number 335, once a lady asked the Prophet, "I would love to pray with you," the lady said. And the Prophet replied, "I know you'd love to pray with me, but your prayer in your inner room would be better than praying in your house. The prayer in your house would be better than praying in the courtyard. Your praying in your courtyard would be better than praying in the mosque where you live, where around your people. Your praying in the mosque where you live, around your people, is better than praying in my mosque." So that means for a woman, the best prayer is the inner room.
Masha.
And the various hadith that praying in your room is better than the house, house better than the courtyard, courtyard better than the mosque in your area, then mosque in your better than the mosque of the Prophet. Though the Prophet said, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 2, hadith number 3210, that praying in my mosque is equivalent to 1,000 prayers. That means if you pray in the mosque of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it's equal to praying 1,000 times in any other mosque. But this hadith is mainly referring to the men, because no two Sahih hadith can contradict. So this hadith mainly refers to the men. For the woman, the best place is the house, especially her inner room. And there's a hadith in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, Book of Salah, hadith number 591. Umm Warqa, may Allah be pleased with her.
Ameen.
She comes to the Prophet and says that, "I would like to have a muadhin in my house." And the Prophet gave her permission. The next hadith, Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, Book of Salah, hadith number 592, it says that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he went to a house after appointing the muadhin, and he asked her to lead the prayer in congregation, and the woman in the house, they joined her. And the narrator says that he saw the muadhin, he was an old person. It's further mentioned in a Sahih hadith of Bihaqi, hadith number 1922. Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, who is the wife of the Prophet, she says that she led the congregation of the woman. She was the imam, but she stood in the middle of the row. And another hadith in Musannaf ibn Abi Shayba, hadith number 4953, Umm Salma, who was also the wife of the Prophet, may Allah be pleased with her,
Amen.
Even she said that she led, she was the imam of a congregation of women, and she was standing in the center of the first row. So here it indicates that the women, they can pray, but it is better for them to pray in the inner room, better than going in the mosque. But they are permitted to go in the mosque, as we discussed earlier yesterday, that praying in the mosque is permitted, but for them, the inner room is better than the house is better than the courtyard better than the mosque close to them. than the mosque of the Prophet. But they can pray, they can go to the mosque. If they pray at home, they can have a congregation. There's no problem at all. And a woman can lead the congregation according to the various hadith I mentioned.
With women?
Yes.
Yeah. Next question, Dr. Zakir. Is it okay for a person who's following an imam in a congregational salah to hold a Quran in front of him whilst the imam's reciting?
As far as holding the Quran for a muqtadi while offering Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan, and we do see that sometimes people hold, when we see the live telecast of the Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan from the haram, we find some people holding the mushaf, the copy of the Quran. Is it allowed? When we realize that if a person holds the mushaf, the copy of the Quran, he is unable to follow that, keep his right hand over his left hand, which is a requirement for salah. He can't put his right hand over the left hand, so he's not following one of the requirements of salah. Furthermore, it will be a distraction for him to turn the page over. You know, if the imam keeps on reciting for him to turn, it's a distraction. Furthermore, it will also prevent him from looking at the place of sujood. Normally, your eyes should be looking at the place of sujood, that's what the hadith says. So if they're looking at the mushaf, they cannot look there. And it will prevent them from various other actions of ruku, it will be uncomfortable, sujood uncomfortable. So it is not advisable for a person to hold the mushaf and, you know, while the imam is reciting. He should just listen to the Quran, what he knows by heart. Alhamdulillah, what he doesn't know, he should pay attention and try and listen, as the Quran says that whenever you hear the Quran, you hear the Quran, then pay attention to it and listen to it. So that's what you should do. It's not advisable to hold the mushaf.
Okay, that's well answered. Thank you very much. Totally agree with you on that one. Alhamdulillah. Another question for you, Dr. Zakir. The viewer says, I pray Taraweeh in the mosque behind the imam, but I want to pray more rak'ah in tahajjud. Should I avoid witr behind the imam, or should I pray the witr behind the imam and later repeat my witr?
As far as the practice and the saying of Muhammad is concerned, our beloved Prophet said, it's mentioned Sunan Abu Dawud, poem number 1, book of Salah, hadith number 1370, the beloved Prophet, he said that when the people asked him to stay longer and pray more, so he said that a person who prays with the imam till he ends, it is as though he has prayed for the full night. And the other hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 472, which says that when the person asks the Prophet about Qiyamul Layl, Prophet said that you have to pray 2 rakat, followed by 2 rakat, then 2 rakat, then 2 rakat, and when you fear dawn coming, then pray 1 rakat. And the other hadith says that you can pray as much as you wish. So based on these two hadith, the best a person can have 2 options. One is that he has to pray till the end of the imam. He can't come away from the salah and not offer witr, because then he will not be, as the Prophet said, he would not be like a person who's prayed till the end along with the imam. As the hadith of Abu Dawud 1370 says, that if he prays till the end along with the imam, as though he has prayed the full night. So the best is he prays along with the imam, also prays witr, and then afterwards, later on, if he wants to offer tahajjud, tahajjud is the same as Qiyamul Layl. Tahajjud means waking up again. So he goes home, he sleeps, and he wakes up again. He can again pray, but he should not offer witr, because there's no 2 witr. There's only 1 witr. Or the other option is that he prays along with the imam, and when the imam, in the last rak'ah of witr, when he ends his salah, this person should get up and pray 1 more rak'at. So when he prays 1 more rak'at, it doesn't become witr. And when he goes home, prays the tahajjud and then prays the witr. Here, he's following the hadith, he's praying till the end with the imam. So he gets the sawab of praying for the full night. And yet he goes home and he prays. And the witr is normally the last prayer is preferable. So he goes home and he again prays the tahajjud. And after tahajjud, he prays the witr. That is the second option, which is preferable, but the first is also fine.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. Next question. How much Quran should one recite in each rak'ah of Taraweeh?
There is no fixed rule per se. There's no limitation, but the Prophet did say that as much as you recite, it's better.
We have in the hadith of Mustadak al-Hakim, hadith number 1160, that the beloved Prophet, he said that anyone who recites 100 verses, he will be counted among those who are obedient. The next hadith of Mustadak al-Hakim, hadith number 1161, that anyone who recites 100 verses will not be counted among the negligent. And the hadith of Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 1393, which says that anyone who recites 10 verses in the Qiyamul Layl, that is the night prayer, he will not be counted among the negligent. Anyone who recites 100 verses will be counted amongst the obedient. And anyone who recites 1,000 verses will get huge sum of rewards. So as much as you recite, it's better. It's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 1, hadith number 1697, that a Sahaba joins the Prophet and in Qiyamul Layl, and the Prophet continues, and he, as I mentioned earlier, he prays Surah Baqarah, and he thinks he's going to end after 100 verses. He continues, 200 verses, he continues. He thinks he'll end, he'll go in Ruku after Surah Baqarah. Prophet continues, of course, Surah Nisa. Then he thinks after Surah Nisa, he'll go. Then he continues Surah Imran and continues praying. That means, you know, more than 5 juz. That's how long the Prophet prayed. We also have the hadith, which is mentioned in Muwatta Imam Malik, volume 1, in the book of prayer, chapter number 2, hadith number 4. Where Ubay bin Ka'b, when he led the Salah, he used to recite 100 verses of the surah, long verses. And the recitation was slow, so people used to get tired and lean on the stick. And many times it used to continue till close to Fajr Salah, very long. But the Prophet also said, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 1, Book of Salah, hadith number 943, that when you're leading a congregation, do not lengthen your salah too much, because there are women, there are elderly people behind you, they get tired, so you have to shorten your prayer. And the Prophet then continued to say that if you're praying in congregation, then it's good to don't lengthen too much, but if you're praying alone, you can pray as much as you wish. As the Prophet, he prayed more than 5 juz. If you're alone, you can pray as much as you wish, but in a congregation, you can lengthen it, but don't make it too much. Don't go too much. It will cause a problem to the people who are in your congregation, the young children, the women, the elderly people. So that should be the size.
Be balanced, in other words.
That's right.
Alhamdulillah. Next question, Dr. Zakir. Is it permissible to pray Taraweeh at home? Okay. If a husband leaves the wife and children in Taraweeh, will he get the reward equal to those who pray Taraweeh in congregation in the mosque or the masjid?
Praying in congregation is preferable than praying alone, as we discussed earlier. Praying in the mosque is preferable than praying at home. So for the man, it's preferable that he goes to the mosque and joins the congregation. But as far as the women are concerned, the prayer in the inner room is better than prayer in the house, house better than courtyard, courtyard better than mosque. So it's preferable that the women pray at home. And if they want, they can make a congregation at home. That's the best, as we discussed earlier. That would be the best, that the women pray at home and they have a congregation. But the man, it's preferable that he prays in the mosque.
Brothers and sisters, I truly hope, inshallah, that you have benefited enormously and you've learnt lots and lots about the night prayer. And I would wish you to continue watching our series, Ramadan, A Date with Dr. Zakir. Tomorrow, we will be discussing the topic, Ramadan, the month of the Quran, part 1. So join us again, same time, tomorrow. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. حافظين ذاكرين قانتين خاشعين مسلمين مؤمنين للإله عابدين شهرنا صوم وعتق وقنوت فيه صدق يومنا صبر ورفق بدموع البائسين رمضان قد أهل بالصيام وأطل مسعدا أهلا وخلا لتهو